I'm Kurt Hamilton, and I would like to welcome you tonight to the 2012 Primary Season Candidates Forum. Now, this is something we started doing a few election cycles back. This year, we are co-hosting it with the Kentucky Farm Bureau Henderson Chapter, and Bob Watson is here. He's going to be emceeing this with me. I'm the chairman of our Public Policy Committee for the Chamber of Commerce. And I tell you what, before we hear from the candidates, I do want to thank our presenting sponsors. First of all, I'd like to thank Infinitech. If you're here from Infinitech. Yay, thank you, Infinitech. Thank you very much for sponsoring this. And I know I saw Barbara Jones from Fulton Jones Insurance. There's Barbara back there. Thank you very much for your sponsorship. ABBA Promotions and Ty Rideout, thank you for sponsoring this. I haven't seen Ty here tonight, but you know, he's hard at work making campaign signs, I bet. And also the Republican Party of Henderson County and the Democratic Party of Henderson County. Announce both together so we get equal flash, right? Okay. And also a very special thank you to the Ramada Inn. We have a much better, bigger location this year than we have in the past, and we really appreciate everyone coming out for this. And finally, Fire Dome for catering this. Michelle, of course, for trying to do this campaign. So thank you very much. All right, one thing I would like to say, I heard this just yesterday, in fact, that a lot of times when we go to the voting panel, you know, we go into the booth, we take a look at names, and we don't have any idea who these people are or what they stand for. And it's kind of sad that that's the case. So I very much appreciate each one of you candidates for number one, running, because I know personally how tough it is, especially when you're on the downside, as I had the experience being. Also, I know the work that goes into it, and I really, really appreciate those of you who aren't running for office to come and get a better understanding of who is, in fact, running for office. So my last thank you will be to the board members and the Public Policy Committee folks that we have here. Raise your hand in the back. Thank you very much for the chamber. We also have some Farm Bureau, Farm Bureau board members. But with that, I'm going to hand it over to Bob Watson, and he's going to introduce our first race.
I'm going to go over the ground rules and stuff that will be taking place tonight. First of all, if you have a cell phone, and I think everybody does, please put it on vibrate or turn it off. If you want excitement, put it on vibrate and put it in your pocket. Just make sure it doesn't make any sounds, okay? All right, 4-minute ground rules. There will be no biting, kicking, punching, or hitting below the belt. No, it's just politics. Disregard the last one. Candidates will have 3.5 minutes to speak at the mic. With 30 seconds left, the candidate will be shown a yellow card from our timekeeper, Mr. Combs. When time is up, the bell will ring. At 4 minutes, it will be shut. Candidates are urged to be available to audience members for questions before and after their time at the mic. Candidates are wearing name tags to help identify them. Candidates should have checked in with our candidate liaisons. If they've not, please do so now at the entrance to the meeting room. As a courtesy to other audience members, please keep your voices lowered while candidates are speaking. Feel free to use the hallway or lobby area for more in-depth conversations. There will be a brief intermission about midway through the program, around 7 o'clock. Candidates who are uncontested in both the primary and general elections who want to turn at the mic will be able to do so at the end of the program. And we'll get started with the first on the agenda will be for Henderson, Circuit Court Clerk, and Mr. Larry Leslie will go first.
Leslie, and I am the opening act for tonight. I'd like to thank you first of all for everyone attending this evening and the opportunity to introduce myself as candidate for Circuit Court Clerk. I'd like to briefly describe my background. I'm a lifelong resident of Henderson County. My wife, Lisa, works at Old National Bank. She's the manager there. We're celebrating our 15th wedding anniversary this year. Following my graduation from Western Kentucky University, that was in 1986, I began work at Peabody Coal which was the corporate headquarters here now where the police station is. Following that time, I worked for Danland Development as a county manager for approximately 10 years. That's a John Danheiser owned company. And then after that, I became the senior accountant at the city of Henderson for approximately 10 years. Currently, I am employed at Gillis Cycling and Fitness over in Evansville. Most of you guys know I'm a big bicyclist fan, so it works out well for me. Not only do I want to mention my background as far as my training and experience, but I also feel that these skills that I've developed through my work career allow me to provide an organization, stability, and leadership to the clerk's office and make the office a better place for everybody. This is the time of fresh ideas and a renewed energy and focus and direction and leadership are necessary for the office to function efficiently and effectively. And in closing, I would just like to ask everyone for their vote on May 22nd, you and your friends and your family. And also, we're having a kickoff at Rookies tomorrow evening at 5 o'clock, 5 to 7, and everyone's welcome to join us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our next candidate will be Ruth London.
That's pretty close. Okay, is this where everyone can hear? Has my 3 minutes started yet? I wanted to say thank you to the Chamber of Commerce and to Farm Bureau for hosting this, as well as all of the other sponsors that I was not aware of, those that have provided food and such. My deepest thanks to you all for doing that. I am Ruth London, and I am currently Circuit Court Clerk for Henderson County. I think I need to just get rid of the notebook. I'm a lifelong resident of Henderson County. Have been so for 58 years, and I currently serve as you in our community of Henderson as your Circuit Court Clerk, having done so for the past 6.5 years. I've been clerk for 6.5 years. I've been there a few years more than that, but I have served as clerk for 6.5 years. And my eyesight is diminishing as well. It's been a privilege and an honor, truly. And I'm very humbled to have been afforded the opportunity to do so. I also know without a doubt that God has placed me in that position. And I draw my strength and guidance daily from Him, as He plainly and clearly says to me, "Trust me." There are doubts sometimes, but trust me is what I hear from Him. To hold the office of Circuit Court Clerk is not just a job, it is a career. Something that I have put my entire self and heart into in order to help meet the needs of people from all walks of life at the times they are in difficult times and are perhaps facing a crisis. Sometimes the listening ear is what they may need, while other instances may require in-depth time given to help bring a satisfactory resolution to their problem. The ailing budget of our state government has been a challenge for some time. I believe in being a good steward of the resources given to me and will continue to find ways to help buffer some of the shortfalls that have beset our state. Our office currently does so. On November the 18th of 2011 was the first time in the 6.5 years in my tenure as clerk that my office finally became fully staffed with 23 deputies. Over a period of the last 2 to 3 years, due to budget shortfalls and hiring freezes, illnesses, deaths, vacations, sick leave, we have been as short-staffed at times as 17. And when you have to take folks into the courtroom, you also have to help with the judges. And we have had only as many as 9 in our office because that we, not just me, my excellent staff, has provided the service that has kept the courts going.
Ruthie was the first to experience. Our committee member, John Coombs, candidates, when he shows you a yellow card, that means you've gone 3 minutes, okay? And we have 3.5 minutes allotted, all right? So you hear the bell, and he starts glaring a little bit. So,
I missed the yellow card because I was sorry.
I guess, well, you know how they do on TV. I guess the idea is to finish your thought, and then we'll move on. We do have a long night. Thank you very much. Thank you, Larry, as well. All right, I have the privilege of introducing the District 7 state representative candidates. Now, for those of us that live in Henderson but don't live in District 7, you wonder kind of where it is. Well, obviously with the redistricting issues, we're not really too sure, but for now, I know it goes from Sturgis in Union County through Henderson County and almost all the way to Owensboro, I guess, in Davis County. So it does affect us here in Henderson. I'd first like to introduce Tim Klein. Thank you very much. I want to thank the Chamber for hosting this event. I want to thank all of you for taking time out of your busy schedules to be here tonight. And I want to thank the sponsors for putting this on. I think it's vital that we stay engaged in politics no matter what your political leanings are. So again, thank you all for being here. As a lawyer, I can tell you I don't think I've ever spoken for 3.5 minutes or less, so bear with me here, and I try to avoid the gong. Let me give you a little bit of background about myself. I'm from Davis County, graduated from Davis County High School in 1995. Left there that year and attended the Air Force Academy. Spent 4 years there, 5 years on active duty in the Air Force as an intelligence officer. I spent about 5.5 months over in Saudi Arabia. Got out, went to law school, live in Owensboro now with my wife and my two girls, and practice law here in Henderson at Stahl, Keenan, Ogden, which is downtown on the corner of 2nd and Main. Let me tell you now a little bit about why I'm running. One of the major themes that I'm focusing on is keeping Kentucky competitive. If you look at the numbers across the board, Kentucky ranks near the bottom in almost every category. Whether you buy into those or not, I'm not sure, but I think we all maybe feel that we could do better in some areas. The two things that I think we need to do to be competitive are to maintain our competitive advantages. And what do I mean by that? We've got a coal industry here that is absolutely vital, and we've got to protect it. It's under attack by the federal EPA, and we need to do what we can do as a legislature in this state to take care of our coal business. The second thing we need to protect is agriculture. That's a great asset to this state, and we need to protect it. But we can't just stop with those two competitive advantages. We need to create new ones. Every single state in this country has a tax scheme. Ours is not very good. There's a little dog and pony show going on in Frankfurt right now, and I hope something comes out of it, but they did this in 95 and nothing came out of it. They did it in 2003 and nothing came out of it. We need the political will to make real tax reform, to make businesses want to come to Kentucky. We can't just rest on our laurels and rely on cheap energy, so we need real tax reform. We also need regulatory reform. There were two bills that were sponsored and passed the Senate. Overwhelmingly, these were not controversial bills that died in the Democratic-controlled House. They never even got a hearing. These bills would have put sunset provisions on regulations that burden business people around the state. It would have put sunset provisions on commissions and boards, and also would have given the legislature a veto over regulations. Right now, regulations become force of law without any legislative approval. So those are some of the things that I'm focusing on. I also think we need pension reform, and I vow to not take a dime from the state employee pension fund if I'm elected. I think all legislators ought to give that up. The people of Kentucky don't need to be funding our retirement. That's all I have. I'd be happy to talk with any of you afterwards and answer any questions you have. Thank you very much. Thank you, Tim. And Tim will be in the Republican primary for that seat. Now we have Jim Murphy, who will be in the Democratic primary for District 7 State Representative.
Okay, I was down the hall a little bit. I want to say who's got the flag and who's got the gun. I'm Jim Murphy, and I'm candidate for State Representative in the 7th District. And you're right, the 7th District is a little bit funny. It has 10 precincts in Henderson County. It's kind of the far part of Henderson County. It's got 14 precincts in Davis County and all of Union County. I'm the oldest of 12 children. I was born and raised on a farm in western Davis County. My wife and I have been married for 40 years. Janet, we've got 5 children and 8 grandchildren. I'm running for this job because of families, jobs, and education. I think we need somebody in Frankfort that'll stand up for the families and listen to the legislation that's being passed and how it affects the families. First 17 years of my life, I was farming. I was in agriculture. I got out of agriculture, and thank goodness for industry. I went to work at Alcan Aluminum, and I've been there for the last 25 years. Alcan and Century Aluminum supports about directly and indirectly 4,000 to 5,000 jobs here in this area, and we need to protect these two industries. They're dying. There used to be 20 smelters in the U.S., and it's down to about 6 right now. And we were talking, we've got to do something to make them survive the next 40 years. Education. Education is important to me, and I want to support it from early childhood through postgraduate education. College is important. But we also in the industry have a real need for craftspeople, for electricians. So I think we've got to look to the technical school to prepare the workforce for the industry that we have here in this local area. We at Alcan have had trouble hiring electricians and mechanics this year. It's because they're not out there, and we need to have better education for them. I'd like to thank the Chamber for tonight for having us out in Farm Bureau, and I'd like to thank the people in the audience for coming out to listen to the candidates. That's something that we need to do more of, so I appreciate you coming. Thank you.
All right, and finally we have Representative John Arnold, who's going to be represented tonight by his wife, Sandy.
My name is Sandy Arnold, and I am here to represent my husband, John Arnold, who is the current state representative and is running for re-election. John's background includes health care. He's a retired chiropractor. He has farming background. He grew up on the farm. We own a small farm. And he also has been involved in economic development in his years in politics as well as in city activities. He could not be here tonight because he's home recuperating from open heart surgery. He had surgery, 4 bypass surgery, March the 2nd, and acquired a recent staph infection this week. But he's doing very well and can't wait to get back on the campaign trail. He appreciates the opportunity to be invited here by the Chamber and the Farm Bureau, and he has enjoyed serving District 7 as your state representative and would like the opportunity to go back to Frankfort and continue to work on projects that just enhance the lives of all the citizens of District 7. So once again, thank you for allowing me to explain why he's not with us tonight and ask for your support and vote in May. Thank you.
Next we have the District 11 State Representative, Mr. Paul Despain, who's the Republican.
Well, I was told I need to move this so you can hear me, but don't take it out of the stand. So, can everybody hear me okay? I want to thank you for being here tonight. It's very important that as people who are looking for the future in the next election, and who they're going to be voting for, to get an idea of where we really stand. And to ask someone to kind of give you an overall view of their position in 3 minutes is it's a pretty tough thing to do. But let me kind of give you some of the idea of where I'm coming from. First of all, I want to tell you that my position is that I am pro-life. I'm also a pro-Second Amendment. I am a member of the NRA. My feeling is if you take away the guns from the law-abiding citizens, you make it a criminal's playground to be able to do anything they want to do. So I firmly want to and believe in upholding the Second Amendment. And there's another one I want you to think about, and it's the Tenth Amendment. The Tenth Amendment has to do with states' rights. It has to do with the fact that the states have rights that the federal government should not overcome. And I'll tell you why that's becoming important, because as you see more and more, our federal government is growing and becoming huge, and it's intruding into our personal lives. And sometimes the last line of defense against a government that's becoming so intrusive is your state legislature. It's a state itself that has the ability, that's been given those constitutional rights by the 10th Amendment, to stand up for itself and to take a position that it doesn't agree with, especially unconstitutional things. I don't know if you've been keeping up with the news much lately, but there was a recent poll out by ABC News, a Washington Post poll. And what they asked was, do you oppose or support Obamacare? And according to their poll, 53% of the American people oppose Obamacare. And I'm going to sit here and tell you tonight that I do myself. It is a huge financial burden on our country. It will create financial problems for us for years and years. There are taxes in there, $210 billion worth of taxes, a payroll taxes. It's in that Obamacare. It targets Medicare recipients. Everybody's worried about Medicare being attacked by the upcoming election. The Obamacare took $500 billion out of Medicare. They took away the Medicare Advantage program. They're taking $20 billion of taxes to be put on those things which are medical devices for people who use them as patients, like oxygen and so forth. So I am taking those positions. That's where my stance is. I believe we have a firm position to stand and help our state take a position against too much intrusion into our government. So thank you so much.
Next we have Dr. David Watkins, Democrat.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate all y'all coming out tonight. I was listening to Paul, and last year, the last time we ran against each other, I admonished him that he ought to be running against Ed Whitfield, and like still sounds like he still should be. But again, I do appreciate all y'all being out here, and I appreciate the chamber for having this. Again, I appreciate the Farm Bureau. Again, I help support the Farm Bureau, and I appreciate them all so very much. Again, I have to go back up to Frankfort tomorrow. We have some unfinished business up there. In fact, I was very disappointed with our legislative session. The first 6 weeks of our legislative session this year was spent to redistricting. Now, I will have to say this. I'm kind of proud of our Supreme Court because they helped get rid of two of my opponents. Again, that was awful nice of them to do that, and I truly appreciate it. But we will be doing redistricting next year. Again, we had a budget, and we actually, I've been up there 6 years. This is the first budget that we passed in a regular session since I've been up there. So I'm going to applaud that. I think that was good. And, you know, to me, we ought to be passing one every time that we're up there. But there is a lot of partisanism, and I just, you know, it really does upset me that we can't sit down and across the table from each other and do a lot more talking than we are able to do. Basically, Mr. Murphy, who's running over in the 7th District, he mentioned that our smelters are in trouble. Well, we have actually a smelter caucus up there that we've been working with and trying to figure out. We have about 5,000 jobs that are in jeopardy here in the Henderson and Hancock and Owensboro and Davis County area, and it's a real worry to us, and we're trying to figure out and trying to get a handle. In fact, we found a little bit of money in the budget to get an outside consultant to kind of help us figure out if there's some way that we can help our smelters and make sure that we do not lose those 5,000 jobs in this area, because it would devastate our area. We had a young lady come over from West Virginia that they had closed one of the smelters there, and she kind of made us aware of the devastation that takes place when that happens. Again, y'all been reading about the mill bill. Let me get it right here. Pill mill bill, and that's House Bill 4, and that's a real worry to me. In that, basically speaking, it's going to put a lot more work in physicians' office. By the way, I am family physician here in Henderson, have been so for about 30 some odd years. And again, I have some worries. I happen to be on the conference committee, and we will be meeting again tomorrow, and I suspect this bill will pass in some fashion or form. And again, my time's up. Thank you all very much. Appreciate everything.
Thank you, Doctor. Okay, next. Now, I do want to say that after we hear from our 1st District Congressional candidates, we are going to take an intermission. I see that Fire Dome's in the back reloading the food and beverages, so sit tight for a minute. First, I'd like to introduce, as a candidate in the Democratic primary for the 1st District United States Representative in Congress, this is Charles Hatchett.
The papers in your chairs is a picture of this hydrogen plant. This is the first hydrogen plant in the world, and it was in 2010, and I've talked to my Republican friends as well as the Democrat friends here, and I would like for us to see hydrogen plants put in Western Kentucky. Supposedly, one of the people who was thinking about this in northern Indiana, they did a survey of all the places that this would be the largest, where there could be the largest hydrogen plant in the world, and they came up with Western Kentucky. We've got the rivers. Each one of these little dams that's on the Ohio River provides a pool for a hydrogen plant. Of course, the lakes are, you know, are man-made lakes, so there's no shorelines that have to be protected. The USET plant, which maybe there's a possibility down there at Dam 53, that this could be something that would be a trade-off with our Republicans here in the in Kentucky. They could trade President Obama, give him a green plant, and you know, this would be like Kentucky basketball. Throw the assist to Obama to get a green plant, and then let Obama throw the assist back to the Republicans to save USAID. But anyway, we got to get some things working here. But this is several thousand jobs, several thousand jobs. And if you look at this Kentucky paper here, you'll see down here that the EPA is getting stricter on coal. So it's just a matter of time. I know coal is what we need. We got to hang with it. And we compliment all of the people trying to save the coal. But eventually, we're going to have to be green, because we just can't. If you read these things and you read your paper, you'll understand that the hydrogen makes a lot more sense. You can also do coal gasification. You can also do all kinds of different things. Like, you can have a permanent fuel station, just like the cell phone, you know, replace telephone lines. You can actually have a hydrogen fuel cell at this hotel, and they wouldn't even have to be any longer on the electricity. You can have hydrogen cars. The Hyundai has got it. Or the Honda's got it. The Hyundai has got it. Ford Fusion has got hydrogen models that they're running. So this is something I want us to think about, because we've got the water here. And we've also got the blessing of the environmentalists that this could be here. Now, also, you know, I want to tell you what I ran 2 years ago. I am a candidate who will have a council in the district. And I made an agreement a long time ago against Mr. Whitfield that I would work for $39,300. We're going to use the rest of that salary to pay for the council in the district. The reason we're doing that is right now, in our congressional district, there's 712,000 people. In the Constitution, there was only 30,000 people to every representative. Also, there was also one session that started the first Monday in December and ended by Christmas. So our whole system is turned upside down. We need to change the access point from the, instead of Washington, D.C., we want to change it back to the district, so that the people in the district and the council is just like a city mayor has a city council, so they have a say-so. Are we done with our 30 seconds, Steve? Wow. Yes. All right. Mr. Kitchen is back there in the back. He's a lobbyist. At least say something to him. Thank you.
Hey, thank you. Next, we have in the Democratic primary, Dr. James Buckmaster.
I'm James Buckmaster. I've ran the Corpus Christi Clinic here in town for the last 15 years. It's a clinic for the working poor and those that are uninsured and those with poor insurance. And we've been able to provide a living for my family. and also provide good service for the people that is an affordable price in the community. And I've been able to raise my 8 children and put several of them through college already, and still be able to keep our costs down for those that need it the most in Henderson. Healthcare is a big part of my field, because obviously I'm a physician. And you know, we've talked a lot about Obamacare and how it's going to pan out here in the Supreme Court. Personally, as a physician, I hope it dies, okay? Because I see it destroying the medical community and destroying the convenience of care. You'll have free medical care, but it will not be accessible. It'll be clogged up with everybody that doesn't have to pay anything, and they're just going to go in. And on my website, I provide an alternative for it. Now, everybody's talking about getting rid of Obamacare, but they're not talking much about what to provide. But I have a lot of my patients who come in, and they have jobs, and they have diabetes or a heart attack, and they cannot afford insurance. Their premiums are $1,200 a month. And I proposed perhaps we would provide an insurance plan to them for $150 a month, and let the government subsidize that program. And then they could have a Volkswagen-type policy where they have a $5,000 deductible, but we'd add a medical savings plan to that. So if they hit that, then it wouldn't be that much out of pocket. I had a guy today who paid $17,000 just to go into the hospital for diabetes. And I mean, he's just about broke. I mean, if he just hit $5,000, you know, you could go to the church or somewhere else and say, I need $5,000. But if you go to the church and say, I need $250,000, it's a different program. And that's where we need to get. If we give them a plan where they own it and they have their money in it, then they will respect that plan and they will not abuse it. And that's on my webpage if you'd like to read it sometime. But, you know, we have, the reason why I've gone into this campaign was because of the deficit. I mean, it's gotten so much out of control, and Obamacare is just going to make it worse. But, you know, we have to get control of the spending. And we've had politician after politician come to Henderson and talk about that, and then go right back and do the same thing over and over again. You know, and, you know, we've built this country, and we have just groaned and moaned every day to get out of our beds, to go back and hammer and pound it until this country took form. And we built the greatest country ever seen in the history of mankind. And I see our freedom slipping away each day. Being a Catholic and Obamacare coming after me as a physician and saying, you will have to give the abortion pill. I'm pro-life, I'm not giving it, I'm going to give up my job. And that's the way it is. And we, you know, I don't want the government coming to me and telling me where my pursuit of happiness starts and where it ends, because that's guaranteed in the Constitution. And they need to read it again, because obviously they've missed a few pages. I hope for your support. I have plenty of material around. I ask for your support in this election. I disagree with the gas plants in the community, because I got a bunch of coal miners that are working underground and aren't happy with that idea at all. I appreciate y'all's support. Thank you.
Okay, finally, in our last candidate before our intermission, running unopposed in the Republican primary is Representative Ed Whitfield, and for him tonight is Michael Tate, the district coordinator.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Lower this mic a little. It's great to be here with you tonight on behalf of Congressman Whitfield. I know the congressman wanted to be here. He was in Henderson yesterday. We spent a full day traveling around Henderson. We were at South Heights Elementary School, which is a school in this community that everyone can be proud of. They're doing great work there. They're teaching our children to be very productive citizens, and the sky's the limit for their future at that school. And the congressman had a great time visiting with them and talking with them for about 2 hours at South Heights. Yesterday also we had the chance to go to the coal mine over in Union County, Riverview Coal Mine, and meet with about 270 coal miners. And I can tell you, there's not a stronger advocate for coal in the United States, in the Congress of the United States, than Congressman Ed Whitfield. And the miners there know that. The Kentucky Coal Association was there with us, and they presented the congressman with this license plate. And what this means is 50,000 people in Kentucky had purchased this plate to talk about the importance of coal. And it says, they're very simple, coal keeps the lights on. Could be truer, because these elections this fall, especially at the national level, are about our economy, about getting our economy back on track and getting the American experience back to what it used to be. And the big difference, and some of the candidates have mentioned it here tonight, is that the current administration in Washington just doesn't seem to get it. They're doing the total opposite of what it takes to grow jobs in America and to put people back to work. And Congressman Whitfield, I'm proud to say, has been a strong representative for everyone here in Henderson, whether you're a Democrat, a Republican, or an independent, in terms of the values that he holds and the efforts that he is making in Washington to represent us. Now listen to Dr. Buckmaster talk about Obamacare. Well, Congressman Whitfield couldn't agree more. It was the wrong thing to do for our country. Not that it didn't have an intention of making sure people that didn't have health insurance had it, or people that couldn't afford health care be able to receive it, but it went about it the totally wrong way. And the congressman did not support it. In fact, in the House of Representatives, he was a strong advocate when they came to the floor for a vote to say, hey, we need to at least amend this bill and do some things that make sense in it before we vote on it. But the Speaker of the House at the time, Nancy Pelosi, wouldn't even allow one amendment to be offered. And so it passed because in Congress at the time, there was a Democrat majority in the House. Well, now the House is controlled by the Republican Party, and the first order of business last year was to repeal Obamacare in the House. But it was dead on arrival in the Senate because Harry Reid would not let it come to a floor for a vote. So now it's before the U.S. Supreme Court, and we hope that the U.S. Supreme Court will say this law should not stand because it is unconstitutional. And the congressman knows that and has been working very hard about that. But we go back to jobs and the economy. What this is about this year is creating jobs for our country and doing the things that make that happen. And Congressman Whitfield has been a strong advocate for that, for coal and energy. He's the chairman of the Energy and Power Subcommittee in the House. Why is that important? Because it has everything to do with our energy issues in this country. And I'll say one other thing. What gives Kentucky clout in the U.S. Congress is not that it has six members of the House of Representatives compared to 56 that California has, but that it has members of the U.S. House that have seniority and experience and are doing the right things for this country. And because Congressman Whitfield is the chairman of that subcommittee, and Hal Rogers is the chairman of the Appropriations Committee, and Mitch McConnell is the minority leader of the U.S. Senate, that's what gives us a voice in Washington that really counts. Thank you.
Okay, what we're going to do is reconvene in about 15 minutes, and please take this time to hear from the candidates for City Commission. Bob?
We got a pretty good list here of qualified candidates. First up tonight will be Tom Davis.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And first of all, thanks to the Chamber of Commerce and Farm Bureau for their primary sponsorship, and then everybody else that's on the list. But most of all, thank all of you for being here. This is probably one of the largest turnouts I've seen in quite a few years at one of these types of functions, and your interest in meeting the candidates, wanting to know more about us is great news for us. And it's also to see that I think it's close to 100% participation from the candidates, which is very, sorry to say, very unusual at one of these functions sometimes, but it's wonderful for you get the opportunity to meet all of us. I'm tying up a lot of my time with thanking you for that and thanking the candidates because I was your mayor for 4 years. I think most of you here know me and what I'm about, know what family I come from. I have my father, Snaz, here with me tonight, who's been a supporter of city government, past city commissioner over his many years, and is my primary support mechanism right now. And ask that you give me consideration for the city commissioner seats that are coming up in the primary May 22nd. But also, I mean, it is we have 12 candidates here tonight for the city commission for the voters of Henderson to take a look at and learn more about. So please give them your attention. I would appreciate your support May the 22nd. All of your cousins, if they're at Fairmont or Fairlawn or anywhere else out there, I need all those votes too if you can dig them up and bring them on with you. But the city, even going back to my term as mayor, the city of Henderson is fortunate in the financial position it's in, and also great, as if you believe the numbers on our employment situation, but it can always be better. We can always do a little better offering more jobs. And even though that's been a key word in a lot of different campaigns, I see the judge sitting back here, and I'm sure he would shake his head yes. Finding jobs right now is not that easy a task. Companies are sitting on their cash reserves. They're not investing in enlarging or expanding at this time. But we can only hope and keep on working toward trying to get them to come to a city that has educated and trained personnel. We have the lowest utility rates almost in the entire United States. We're going to be a hub of transportation with I-69 before long, and hopefully it's built in my lifetime. But we have so many things to offer prospective employers. We just need to keep working toward that goal, and that is not easy. And thank you, Mr. Coons. But I do encourage, just by the fact that you're here, I know that you're going to be one of the first at the polls, but get back out there, encourage your friends, people, your coworkers, your family, to make sure they show up at the polls, because that's where you show your interest and concern for your city, your state, and your federal offices. Thank you again for being here this evening.
Next up will be Mr. Daniel Hancock.
Hello. I would like to start by thanking the Chamber of Commerce, Henderson County Farm Bureau, for co-hosting this event. I'm Daniel Hancock. I'm a firefighter, and I'm running for city commissioner. I believe in the election process, and I think that a wide choice of candidates is good for the voters. Personalities differ, opinions differ, and the belief of what's best for the city is different. It's up to the voters to find a candidate that they believe in and they feel will benefit the city. City leaders should lead by example, hold themselves to a higher standard. They should never ask for something that they're not willing, someone that they're not prepared to do themselves. When sacrifices need to be made, they should be willing to sacrifice first and always put the city and residents before them. I am a public servant by choice, hard work, and some luck. I honestly believe I have the greatest job in the world. I was in a pool of over 100 applicants for the opportunity to serve the public. I did not take this job to become wealthy. The rewards outweigh anything. The feeling I get when we help someone in distress is priceless. Given the opportunity, I would like to serve as a city commissioner in the capacity of a public servant. In closing, I would like the voters to take a long look at all the candidates. And while they are weighing each one's qualifications and credentials, they should think of some characteristics that they want the city leaders to possess. Integrity, honesty, trustworthy, dependable, humble, respect, and committed. Should they be team-oriented, unselfish? When the voters find the candidates that they believe meet their criteria, then they should cast the vote for them and let democracy handle the rest. Thank you.
Next up is Mr. Chad Brooks.
Hi, my name is Chad Brooks, and I'm running for city commissioner. A quick bio, I am a vet of the U.S. Navy. I serve as a hospital corpsman. Public service is not anything new to me whatsoever. I was born and raised in North Carolina to two jarhead parents. My father is right over there. My mother is still in North Carolina. I moved to Henderson because of family. My father lives in Roberts, and my grandparents live in Evansville. I am just a phone call away if they need anything. I guess I'd like to start off with Senator Rand Paul. He has brought forth a bill that bill is titled S-2122. This bill does two things. There are no loopholes, two specific things. This bill quickly defines what a navigable water is. That is a permanent body of water, such as an ocean, a river, a stream, a lake, etc. A permanent body of water. Right now, the EPA and the Army Corps of Engineers are declaring that mud puddles and runoff water from rainstorms and such are navigable waters. This gives them the right to claim your property. The second thing this bill does is if the government wishes to claim your property, you're forced through the eminent domain process. They are to pay double what your property value is. This will discourage government from taking your property. I find it hard to believe that this bill will pass in the Senate as it currently stands. That's why I would support a city version of this bill. We should start small. The power is with us and it goes up, not the other way around. Something else I would like to support is a policy that will dictate that elected officials of the city does not have the power to vote themselves raises. The higher the pay, the more shady characters you will get in government. I believe that we should prevent this from occurring. What else? Let's see. I assume I still have some time left.
You do.
I guess no new taxes. I do not know who Monica is, and hope and change. Thank you.
I'm going to get all my three minutes in, what is it, 56
seconds or whatever.
Listen, one thing I've got to do, I've been speaking a lot, and one thing I fail to do, I've got a wonderful wife. I've been married 31 years to my high school sweetheart, and she's always saying, you never mention me, so she's not here, so I'm mentioning her tonight. and I've got to mention my campaign manager over there, my sister, Gloria. And I'm going to hurry up. There's a lot of things, you know. I'm a two-term city commissioner. Thank God for two terms. I never dreamed I'd be representing the city of Newington years and years ago. But when God puts something on your mind, He usually brings you through it. And if God blesses me with three terms, I just thank the Lord. But what I want to say is, I've been involved in every mayor administration, probably dating back to Newman. And when we did the Hope Farm thing, I guess that's when I got bit by the political bug. But all the way through, one thing I found out working with all that, you can't change anything until you become a voting person and have the power to vote. Just talking about it don't get it done. In order to change your country, in order to change your city, you got to put people in positions that will vote the way you think that your country should be run. And you can't leave people at the top that don't think like you, and you talking down here saying, I wish things would get better, because the people at the top, they're not listening. So this is the most important election. And I want you to hear this. I never thought I'd say that. I heard that about Barack Obama. This is the most important election of y'all time and all this. But this is the most important election in the city of Henderson's history and on the city commission. Because this election, there's no guessing who stands for what, who stands for this, because everybody showed their true colors. Everybody in Henderson knows what Robert Prutt thinks, and they know what every other commissioner thinks. But we don't have any cards to show you anymore. All the cards are on the table. If you want these people, you vote that way. If you want these people, you vote that way. Let me tell you, in 2006, when I ran, I told the people in Canoe Creek area that I don't know what we can do about Canoe Creek, but we can do better than this. Every time it rained, people in the paper with boats putting stuff up on furniture. When the rain water goes down, the mold still left. And then we got city officials for 30 years and never did anything about it. I didn't know what I could do about it, but thank God we did something about it. Number two thing that I wanted to do when I came to city government, I met a little lady on one of the streets out there in over by Fair Acres. She said, I'm running for city commissioner, and I said, I'd like to see, could I get your vote? She said, listen, I don't vote. My family don't vote. We don't believe in that. I said, why come? She said, because everybody down there is crooks. I said, and she said, and if you get involved, you'll be a crook too. I said, well, listen. I said, well, I don't have time to explain it to you, but if I'm elected, I'm going to show it to you. Well, one thing about it, when the city commissioners and the mayors behind closed doors, Robert Prutt didn't join them. Robert Prutt wrote about it and let everybody in Henderson know what the people done. See, that's the kind of commissioner I am. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to tell you how much money we take in. I'm going to tell you where we spend it at. And I'm going to tell you how much money y'all got left.
All right.
Next up is Joe McGarr.
I'd like to thank everybody for coming out tonight. Introduce myself for those of you who don't know me, a little bit about myself. Born and raised in Henderson County my whole life. Spent 2 years in college here, and after the second year got kind of bored with it. I got the wild hair to join the Air Force. Spent 4 years active duty. Three of those years were overseas in Japan. It turned out to be the best decision of my life, and I came out a wiser person, more disciplined, and an overall better person. Three things that they taught us in the Air Force that still stick with me today is their motto, which is integrity first, service before self, and excellence in all we do. Those three things is what I want to bring to the City Commission and what I want to bring to the City of Henderson. I want to see the City Commission act on integrity. I want to put the needs of Henderson before my own personal agenda. That's the service before self part. And finally, excellence in everything I do. I want to take every action, every decision I have, and just with the utmost excellence and for the good of everybody in Henderson. Things I want to see in Henderson. I look around at neighboring cities. I look at Evansville. I look at Owensboro, Newburgh, and I see those places growing exponentially. And then I look at Henderson, and I don't see that. And I have to ask myself that question: why is that? I want to bring new ideas that will, bring Henderson up a notch or two to compete with our surrounding cities. For instance, we're on the riverfront. We're sitting on a gold mine. We need to utilize what we have with us to bring people into Henderson. I know bringing people in, it means starting with more jobs, but it's also more than that. It's about attracting Henderson to outsiders. Also, many of my friends that I went to school with, high school and college with, they moved up. They moved out of Henderson because, in their mind, there's nothing here. We need to give Henderson, an attraction to people. We want to retain our young people. We're letting our best and our brightest leave Henderson because there's nothing here for them. And my biggest goal as a city commissioner would be to just show people that Henderson is a destination place. It's a place to stay, raise your family, and we need to bring in more attractions, more jobs, more retail. And that will be one of my biggest priorities as a city commissioner. Again, I thank everybody for coming out tonight, and I would appreciate your consideration on May 22nd in the primaries. And you guys have a good evening. Thank you.
Our next candidate is Robbie Mills.
Thank you. Pleased to be here tonight, and thank you for everybody that's attending and taking interest in our community. I always like to tell a little byline. Some people play golf and some people go hunting. I serve on the City Commission. It's not necessarily a hobby, but it's something that I enjoy doing. It's a pleasure for me, and it's a challenge. And if you have hobbies and crafts that you like to do, when they're challenging to you, it brings enjoyment to your life. When I'm starting my 14th year on the City Commission, and it is times in city government are not as good as they used to be. Budgets are tight, and when we pay our employees, pay their pension costs and health insurance, we only have about 15% of our budget left. That's not very much money to do things with, so that causes us to be creative. That causes us to look at different ways that we can serve our community. We don't have as much blacktop money. We don't have as much bridge money. We don't have as much money to go to parks as we used to. But I'm thankful we have a super staff on the city government. I serve with great commissioners and mayors. We are sharing ideas with county government like never before. We just had a two-hour joint cooperative study meeting this afternoon, covered about five or six very interesting issues that you're going to hear about in the very near future. City and county government are doing things in our community. That's what you put us there to do. You don't put us there to let Robbie Mills' name be known. You put us there to serve the community. That's what I'm there to do. When I stop doing that, you guys need to vote me out. I enjoy doing what I do, and I think I serve the community well. And we've got some challenges coming. Some of the good things that are going on in our community, of course, riverfront development, the sewer project, downtown sewer project, that is going to culminate with the new paving all the way through downtown. Downtown Henderson is going to look beautiful by the end of the year. And those are some of the neat things that we're doing. You're going to see the tennis courts coming up. You're going to see the river walk coming down Merritt Drive. You're going to see Canoe Creek not flooding. I shouldn't say not flooding. Flooding less than it had in the past. But there is a real effort in city government and in county government to make sure that that ditch is dredged, is maintained, and is funded. Now, guys, we've done it once, but the key is to fund that so you can keep on keeping the creek, making it all the way to the river and not getting into people's homes. So thank you for taking an interest in our community. Feel free to call me anytime. My cell phone's available, 724-1111. I'm willing to debate issues. I'm willing to talk about things. I'm willing to do whatever you would like for me to do. And I enjoy Henderson. And let's keep on working for Henderson. Thank you.
Next, we have Ms. Jan Height.
Taller than I am. Thank you for coming out this evening. Thank you to the Chamber. Thank you to the State Farm Bureau. But most importantly, thank you for being active citizens. A little bit about me. I am not originally from this area. I've lived here in Henderson for about 5 years. I'm from Arkansas. I graduated high school in 2004 and served 4 years in the United States Army, and then met my husband while I was in the Army, and he moved me here. This is his home, and it's my home now. I started college at Henderson Community College in 2010, and since I've been there, I've been very active. I am currently the student government president. I'm currently the president of the Phi Theta Kappa Honor Society. I'm a very active member in the History Club. I've received numerous awards, including the 2012 All-USA Academic Team nominated by the college. I've also been nominated or received the 2012 Who's Who among students in American universities and colleges. A little bit about why I'm running. My main motives, I'm a mother and a wife. I have 4 children total. I have an 11-year-old stepdaughter and a 7-year-old stepdaughter. And then I have a 5-year-old son and a 3-year-old daughter. And I have a vested interest in this community. My husband earns his employment, or earns his paycheck, he's employed at Lowe's. So that's very important to us. My son starts kindergarten this fall. So aside from wanting to make sure that the community, that I leave Henderson better than I found it, that's basically why I'm running, to make sure that my kids have a brighter future than I had. The other reason that I'm running is because I was raised to serve. The beliefs that were instilled in me were to serve others and do what I can for others. I was raised to be fair and raised to leave the world a better place than I found it. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Next we have Mike Farmer.
Well, I would certainly be remiss if I didn't thank the Chamber and the Farm Bureau and all the other sponsors for the opportunity to be here and visit with you tonight. I was sitting over by Robbie a few minutes ago, and if I run out of anything to say, I have Robbie's notes, which he did not bring. Tommy Davis mentioned that he had been there before. I've been around a while, folks. I first ran for city commission in the mid-'80s. I served for 13 years in that tenure, and then took a few years off, and I've been back now, I guess completing my third term this time. There's not a lot new in city government from 1985. It's about collecting money, about serving people, and about doing that as economically as possible and being able to provide the community with the greatest bang for the buck. As Robbie mentioned, it's getting tougher to do that. Pension costs are astronomical for us now. Healthcare costs, not just in everyone's private lives, but for public workers, those healthcare costs have gone up tremendously too. but we've still been able to maintain services to people. We've done that by being frugal, by trying to watch where we spend our money. There have been times over the years, yes, we have to go to the public and ask for more money. When gasoline goes up at the pump for you, it goes up at the pump for the city too. When you buy tires and they're more expensive than they were the last time, but they are for city government too. So I've heard people for years talk about running government like a business. Well, it would be nice to be able to run government like a business. I'm a businessman, and I have some knowledge of how to run a business, but government just operates a little different than a business, because we have to figure out what the community needs and then make the effort to provide those services. You know, we have to continue to have good police and fire protection, our public works department, your streets. I think probably what you get from local government, you see more in your daily life than what you get from the federal government or what you get from the state government. We're here where the rubber meets the road. I'm particularly fond of the fact that we're working with the county in a way like we've never worked with the county before. And I see Hugh sitting back there. Hugh and I started this process called public service about the same time. And we've had many meetings with Hugh representing the county and me representing the city, and some of those meetings weren't very comfortable. But it was always the city and the county trying to take care of the citizens. It's not about me, it's not about Robbie, it's not about Robert or Tommy Davis or anybody else. It's about the city of Henderson and our ability to provide for you the best possible living we can. I would appreciate your vote and support.
Next is Jesse Johnston, the fourth.
Thank you. We are taught throughout life that time will mend all wounds. This teaches us the virtue of patience. But time is something that we do not have. If we do not act soon, we will be burdened like most other communities around the U.S. To succeed as a city, we will have to deal with two important issues: budget stability and drug use. The stability of our city budget is currently threatened by two things: inflation of expenditures and reduction or stagnating revenues. They're affecting the city's ability to keep offering the protection and services that it provides. Devaluation of the dollar has led to an increase in expenses. By 2020, health care will reach over $10 million per year, or budget per year. Based on the 2010-2011 city audits, payroll tax collections have decreased every year since 2007 and have had the smallest increase in property tax revenue, with the biggest increase in taxes since 2003. We are going to have to find ways to deal with inflating expenses while trying to find ways to raise revenues without raising taxes that put a burden on our community. If we can provide a stable city government, we will have a greater possibility of achieving the job growth that we're looking for. The last thing I'd like to briefly talk about is drug use in the community. This must be addressed, or we risk losing not only loved ones, but the capability to provide a labor force that is reliable and skilled for job growth. We have laws to combat drug use. They work if our goal is to deter rational thinkers, but drug users are irrational thinkers. To reverse the problem, we are going to have to take a different approach by educating our community. We need to provide our schools with extra funding and personnel to educate our children. We need to promote the negative effects it has on families and our city. Drug use is becoming an epidemic, and to be successful, it will take all of us as a community to educate our children and each other. I believe that if we work together as a unit with leadership that will make the difficult decisions that lie ahead, we will succeed. With your support, we can lead our city to a brighter future. Thank you, and ask for your vote.
Next, we have Mr. John Shirley. Good evening, each and every one of you. I want to thank the Chamber of Commerce and all the individuals who decided to have this gathering. I want to thank each and every one of you that are here today. My name is John Shirley, Jr. I was born here in Henderson, Kentucky. After graduating Henderson County High, I went to the University of Kentucky in Lexington. After that, I went into the United States Navy. Right now, I'm a deacon at my church. I'm a church officer in my church. So I believe there's nothing more important than that Lord and Savior in your heart. As well as Joshua, we're all servants. But the most important part about being a servant is that you've got to have Lord and Savior in your heart to help you to discern decisions that come up. As I spoken earlier, budget restraints are getting tighter and tighter. We need more and more individuals in our city to have more and more of the capability of thinking outside of the box, because it's going to take that thinking outside of the box to make a decent, sound decision. It can't be done in a few seconds. It can't be done overnight. Sometimes you have to sit, really listen to some of the people without making a decision right then and there. Having said that, I've got a number of friends of mine who work on the city in each and every one of the departments, and I hear their concerns. I can understand where they're coming from when they have to feed their kids. They have to send their kids to school. They have to worry about their kids at school. There's a number of issues out there that are going to affect each and every one of us over the next couple of years. The question is, what and who are the people that have the best capability? My campaign is about a vote for me, it's a vote for you, because I want to make the decision best. I'm not going to be quick in making a decision, and I'm not going to be slow. But I do promise you I will make the best decision that I could possibly do, because I understand where these individuals are coming from that are our city employees. If we would lose one-third of them by going to either Evansville or Owensboro, then we need to have the leaders in our community, in the county, and in the city that have to listen to those individuals. I've got a bunch of friends of mine that have the same problems, and I understand where they're coming from because I know what it feels like. Now, 2 years ago, I said we need to have an incubator. I said it 2 years ago at the country club, and I still got the video. One of the things about that was an incubator draws up those that are caught between the rock and the hard place, those that are trying to get their own business off and growing, those that have the ability to get people hired. Every one of us know people that have been employed, but how many people know and work with Kevin Shealy, who is Northwest Forward? You're talking about right now. I know what Kevin Shealy wants for people, for businesses to grow. I know what Sue Gibbons is looking for because I talk to him every month, sometimes two or three times a day, as far as my own personal business. And because I have my own personal business, I know and I understand what their needs are. Like I said, a vote for me is a vote for you. I appreciate the ability of anyone being able to talk to me at any time about anything that I can do for any one of you. Thank you. Next, we have Alan Taylor.
No one told me 15 months ago when I started as a city commissioner in my first term that the job was a 24/7. But I'm going to skip the introduction because I know you all know who I am, because you stopped me at Walmart and Lowe's and Sherway and at the restaurant, and you expressed concerns about issues, and I try to listen to every one of you. I've never been too busy. We've heard a lot of, I guess, wishes and things that people want to do. I'm going to talk to you about some facts about what's been done in the last 15 months. Last month, we voted for an amendment changing the zoning regulations to reduce that process of permitting from 60 days down to 21. That was a vote that passed, and we accomplished in the last 30 days. In the last 30 days, we have changed the ordinance to allow an expanded moratorium on income tax investments. That has netted us in less than 30 days $890,000 in less than 30 days in investments. That's jobs for electricians, that's jobs for carpenters, that's jobs for Henderson, that's bigger tax revenue in years to come. I voted and supported heartily the change that we asked for back in January of last year. Matter of fact, the first month I was in office, I made the motion that we need to review the sign ordinance. We'd been told by the voters we had a sign ordinance that wasn't necessarily business friendly. I made the motion. The rest of the commission cooperated with that. We got a committee. We got citizens' input. And now we have a new sign ordinance in place that's much more business friendly than what we started with. Let's see, some of these other points. I've got more than I can go through right here. We have, in the past five-year period, taken out $762,600 out of our reserve funds. These were required to be pulled from reserve funds to balance our budget. Well, this fiscal year, 2011-2012, unless the wheels come off, we're not going to have a penny of that reserve money. That's because we made some tough decisions, we made educated policy changes, and we brought the budget under control. You don't have to worry about that in this coming year because of our decisions, and some of them were pretty tough to make. I'm going to close with this final thing. I was in that meeting this afternoon for 2 hours with the Joint City and County Committee, and we're moving forward fast in the plans for Henderson Recycling, and that is going to ultimately pay for itself. That's our projection. In other words, we're going to be providing you more service for no cost at all. It'll be a break-even proposition. That's what we're looking at. Every year that we save our landfill, you, the taxpayers, are saving $5 million that year. That's what we're working on. And if you want that kind of progress to continue, vote for Alan Taylor on May 22nd.
And next up is Byron Hilligan.
Well, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. Not much of a public speaker, but we'll wing it. I moved to Henderson County in 1984. Graduated from Henderson County High School in 1987. Most of the jobs that I've had revolve around jobs where you had to deal with the budget. I worked at the Henderson County Detention Center for 4 years. I was over $75,000 cleaning budget there, and just about cut that cleaning supply budget in half without causing any ill effects to anyone, including the inmates in the facility. I do own my own business. It's Black Diamond Studios Tattoo and Piercing on the far end of town. I see a lot of things that can change in Henderson County, but we have had some good leadership in the past. I think that we can do a little better than what we have had. I'm not a rich man. I go to work every day just like most of you do. I work at Brake Supply in Daylight, Indiana. And I look forward to serving you guys. And that's about all I got to say.
Okay, well, thank you very much. One last thank you to our sponsors, Infintech, Vaughn Jones Insurance, Aber Promotions, the Republican and Democratic parties, and I'd also like to thank my public policy committee, Cindy Burton, Brent Bridges, Mike Friels, Matt Calvert, Yolanda Null, Julie Wisher, and John Coombs on the bell. Thank you very much. Now, our candidates, most of our candidates are still here. They want to talk to you, and so please ask questions, get to know our candidates. I tell you, all around the world, people gripe about their governments, don't they? Whether it's city government, state government, our national government, people gripe all the time. This is the only system of which I'm aware where we can change things if we want to. When you hear someone griping to you, tell them to go vote on May 22nd. tell them that they need to figure out what the candidates running for office stand for, what they're all about. But tell them to vote. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. We will see you in the fall at our debate.